We're super professional now. We don't even talk through our intros anymore. We're so professional.
It's one of those Sundays.
Welcome to the Uglee Truth. This is episode, 613. Oh, there goes the professionalism.
Right? Gerald's like, we don't care what episode it is.
I don't care what he thinks. Right. I'm going to do whatever I want.
Well, it adds context. Discussion. So people know how long we've actually been doing the show.
Some people want to know, and they go, God, they've been doing this for that long?
613
episodes? Of this nonsense?
I know. Huh?
Wow. Anyway, welcome to the Uglee Truth. I am Jamie with my sister, Stefania, as my mother would like to call you. It is spring. Spring has sprung. Is everyone enjoying everything? How was your Easter?
Yeah. It was fine. It was fine. My son enjoyed it, as he usually does.
Good. So as you noticed when you walked in our door today, that our house is in complete disarray.
Oh.
Half the house is vacant. Two of our rooms have nothing in it.
Yeah.
Because Malia moved out. And apparently, and I didn't even realize I was doing it, but the second Malia moved out, I said, all right, that's it. Everyone get dressed. And we just went nuts. I know. So we put new flooring in her room. We have purged many things. You know, we have no furniture in our downstairs because we got rid of the couch. That was absolutely thrashed. We got a new couch.
There's no point in getting new things when you have a bunch of people, humans, that room and everything.
I was talking to Mackenzie yesterday and she's like, Mom, you deserve to have good furniture, goddammit.
You do.
And I said, I know. Well, everyone who's empty nesters, you know. And I told Daryl, I said, listen, because we need chairs, obviously, to add to this living room that only has a couch in
it. It's a work in progress.
It is a work in progress. But I said, yeah, we need chairs. And so we were looking at some stuff. And I said, you know what? These things are going to look like garbage in like 5 years. We need to just take our time, buy contract grade, and just something that will last until we die.
Right.
You know, and just be done with it. Yeah. Because I don't really want to spend, I don't want to go to like Living Spaces, which I'm sure is fine.
Oh, some of their stuff is expensive, but
it's very expensive because we're looking at
quality.
It.
Yeah.
You can get contract grade through them, but it's not that great looking.
Yeah.
Anyway, so.
You have to go where the rich people shop. You just do. I know you. It's difficult.
Well, and we.
It seems like, so incredibly expensive. It's it is. How in the hell can I justify buying this?
We just have to literally incrementally do it. We can't. Yeah. We don't have. We're not rich people.
No, I get it. And by the way, I've seen rich people do these things, and they don't necessarily go out and buy everything. You know, they hire a decorator, but you don't need one because you have impeccable taste. So
that's the problem.
You'll be fine.
That's the problem.
I know.
Today. Daryl, remember how you were kind of, you gave me the eye the last time we were recording.
Uh-oh.
And you're like, well, some people like to invest in themselves, Jamie. And I'm like, I know I need to invest in myself. But it's a hard thing to change.
It's such a hard thing. I'm so guilty. I have no room to talk about investing in oneself.
Oh, please. I'm just a little ahead of the game for you. You're just following me. In a few years, going to be like, I'm where Jamie was. I have to start investing in myself. Yeah. Like, that's what happens.
I still buy clothes off of Amazon.
Stephanie, I bought 3 summer dresses off of Amazon, and I got so many compliments.
I'm telling you.
Like, so many compliments.
It's kind of like the QVC for everyone.
And they're, like, lined cotton dresses. They're nice.
I'm telling you, I have gotten, I will not confess this to people at work, but I mean, I have gotten some really cute things that I wear to work, and you would never know.
You know what? Well, it was funny. We went to Daryl's Brothers for Easter, and I really like gingham. I know it's not gingham. It's the seersucker print where it's the teeny tiny light pink or
super
white.
Cute.
Love it. So I ordered one off of Amazon and I wore it with a denim jacket. It looked really cute. It was kind of a maxi dress. So it was like almost hit the floor, which is my favorite.
Yeah.
Really cute. And I walked
and
in.
And comfortable.
And very
flattering.
Comfy and flattering. Yes. And so I walk in, they're like, oh my God, your dress is so cute. Immediately. I'm like, Amazon. Like immediately.
Right? Like, why do I do that to myself? I do it too.
And Daryl goes, why do women always say that? They either go.
Like you have to tell you where.
They tell you exactly where they got it and if it has pockets.
Right.
Which mine did. And
pockets
I said.
Are very important.
I said, I'll tell you why. I said, because women are always looking for a pretty thing. And the women who gatekeep that shit are assholes.
Yeah.
The rest of us want to know where you got it so we can get it too.
And by the way, we're not going to be your twinsie and buy the exact same thing.
I am happy for women when they find something that makes them feel pretty.
Same.
And if what I'm wearing you think it will make you feel pretty when you wear it, I'm going to tell you exactly how much I paid for it and where I got it.
100%.
And. I think you would agree with this. When we were kids growing up, if you didn't buy your clothes from the mall, Above the Belt, Esprit, Oh God, I love that store. Wet Seal.
Yes.
All those places.
Macy's was great too.
Macy's. But if you didn't buy your clothes there, people knew and judged and they judged you.
Absolutely.
Whereas now, my daughters, when they were in high school, they're like, oh, we went to the thrift store. Like, they literally go to Target.
I mean, still.
Thrift stores.
I have friends who are like that. They're like, are you kidding me? I got this at the thrift store. And I'm like, we've talked about our thrift store aversion. I can't do it, but.
It is hard because, you know, I don't know where these people's thrift stores are, but they have like way nice stuff.
It's kind of like mom's attitude when we were growing up about Ross or Marshall's.
Yeah.
You literally have to go every week.
And you have to dig.
And you have to be willing to invest the time and dig. And if you can't do that, then just don't do it. By the time you go, everything's gone. All the good stuff is gone. Yeah.
I will tell you this. Tyler is a huge fan of secondhand shopping. He has found some incredible deals, some incredible clothes.
Yep.
And he's like, Mom, old men die all the time and their clothes get donated. It's like vintage. And they're vintage and they're nice. And
you can't find stuff like that anymore.
My son is a clothing whore.
Yeah.
And he loves coats more than anyone I know.
Really?
He has so many coats.
That's so interesting.
One time I was in Grass Valley and we were in this tiny little vintage shop and it was this English blazer for men. And it was like this pale yellow green color. Not my fave. But it was so well made and it was directly from England. And I sent him a picture. I said, do you want this? It's your size. You would look amazing in it. And he goes, no, I don't want it. And I'm like, okay. A week later, I should have had you get that. That was a really nice jacket. I'm like, I know.
And I'm sure it's gone and I'm not going back.
Long gone. Yeah. Oh, God, no. No.
Yeah.
Anyway, so I'm like, God, I'm kind of jealous because like if we were going to go to Kmart or something, people would be like, what the fuck is that? When we were kids, but nowadays they'll go, oh, I got it at Target.
Now it doesn't even matter. Labels and all that stuff is so gone.
I'm so jealous.
Yeah.
Why couldn't it have been like that for us?
I mean, that's not actually 100% true. It's certain things you can get away with for the most part, but like shoes.
I don't know, man.
I don't know. I'm not seeing a lot of kids walking around in New Balance.
Well, that's true.
You still have to have Nikes and Adidas or something.
Especially your son.
Well, your son's age, generally speaking, if you go to any elementary school, which I don't recommend unless you have to, but if you must, then look at their feet.
You're right.
They all wear very similar.
You're right. Kohl's, if you can get it at Kohl's, it's fine.
You can get them at Kohl's.
Adidas, Nike, Skechers.
Yeah,
even.
Well, the good thing about brands like that is they recognize that us parents are forced to buy our kids to some extent, you know, brand name stuff.
Yes.
So they've really streamlined the shoe to where you can get a decent shoe for $50 to $100. Yes.
I will say this. I saw a TikTok where this woman goes, holidays haven't been the same since Payless Shoe Source left.
Indeed.
And I'm like, oh my God.
But Payless me became a thing when I was young and poor.
I loved Payless
Shoe Source.
Because
you could get cute shoes. They didn't have to last. Who fucking cares?
No, they have to last you
a year.
3 months.
Right? But you looked like you constantly had something new.
Everybody got their prom shoes there. Everybody got their prom shoes.
We all dyed our satin pumps.
Oh my God,
to match your dress.
I got a pair of fabric kitten heel pumps. They were a navy blue and they were fabric.
Yeah.
I loved the
I think I recall those shoes. Yeah.
Only problem is they didn't breathe.
So they smell.
So they were, even if I wore them for an hour.
They were gross.
It was disgusting.
Yeah. Agreed.
And I'm like, I felt like I was like in a rock and a hard place because they matched everything.
What do you do? Yeah.
I just wore them.
Yeah,
And then luckily I lived alone, so I didn't have to deal with a guy
baby
going.
Baby powder is your friend. I discovered that young.
Oh.
Or cornstarch. Yeah.
That's a really good idea.
It's very absorbent and it disappears after a while.
Why didn't I know that back then?
Because I was queen of the smelly foot. And
one time I had a guy come over.
I had to do something.
I went out like for the evening in these shoes. And a guy.
She wore a kitten heel out.
In a club dancing.
Oh, good Lord.
Came home and took him off and went straight to bed because it was like 2 a.m. And a booty call came.
Oh, no.
And the only thing I can think of is, please do not go below the knee.
Like my feet smell.
Please.
Oh, my God.
I just couldn't get into the program.
You know what? I never thought I would find a purpose for washcloths. All my life, washcloths were like, what do you do with these?
These are poor people.
Right? And so now that I'm older, I have a stack. And washcloths are great for quick, clean anything.
Yes.
Like my dog decided that. I mean, my dogs will always let me know when they have to go out. They don't care if it's 2 a.m. They will tell
They're
me
like,
I have to go out.
Yes.
For whatever reason, we talked about my exhaustion this from my work week. And so I must have been so freaking tired this weekend, Friday night, that I didn't wake up because I woke up to them basically howling and crying. And I'm like, oh God, fine. So I got up and stepped in dog piss. I was like, I'm like, you couldn't have told me. And he's like, hello, trying to tell you, Sleeping Beauty. So that was, it's very rare. I can't even remember. So I'm like, what am I going to do? I cleaned up the mess, of course, in my room, but then I'm like, I stepped in it. I'm like, am I going to shower or put my feet in the bathtub, you know? So no, I went and got a warm washcloth, sudsed it up and washed my feet because God. I couldn't get in my bed.
No.
So yeah, washcloths are your friend. Situations funny. Like this, and including booty calls.
I don't know what speaking of cleanliness, I've been very territorial over my bed lately. So Daryl has been doing a lot of physical work. We've been rowing. We have a rowing machine. Yes. So we row almost daily. He'll row and then, you know, we'll have dinner late and then we'll do whatever. And I'll be in bed clean because I cleanse. I never go to bed dirty.
Sweaty.
No, I'm clean. I'll shower really quick or whatever. And the other thing I do, and I don't know if this is a normal thing or not. I don't really care because I'll never stop doing it, is I will wash my feet before I get in bed.
Okay.
Because if you walk around barefoot or whatever.
Yeah. Even if you have clean floors, there's something.
I hate to give you this because I know you're going to start doing it. Just look at the bottom of your feet before you go to bed.
Well, I have. Jerry and I both happen to have a particularness about that.
Oh, thank God.
He's worse than me. Actually, okay. He probably is what instilled it in me.
Okay, good.
Because
I'm not giving you a thing to worry about.
No. Okay, there's lots of things that he used to notice that I never noticed when I was younger. And over the years, I've realized that, that's...
You're like, So if I take a peek at the bottom of my feet when I'm brushing my teeth, I'm like, oh my God.
You know? We look at the bottom of people's feet on reality shows.
I do that too.
I'm like, look at the bottom of his feet. He's like, oh my God, they're black.
They're filthy.
And you are on film. You're on camera. How do you not think about these things?
I have absolutely done the same thing. So I wash my feet every night, almost every night. I'll just like, nope. And I just do it. And I'm like, I feel clean.
Yes.
And I'm like, and now I can rest. My sheets are clean. Well, Daryl comes wandering in after playing Call of Duty with Josh. And he comes in, it's like 11 o'clock. And he starts taking off all of his clothes. And I go, pause.
Are you going to get in here with your dirty feet?
Are you clean? Are you going to clean up before you get in bed? He's like, you ask me every night.
Well, then don't make me ask you. Just do it.
You worked out. You did yard work. He's like, I was going to rinse.
Oh my God, this is Jerry.
God. And I'm like, okay, great. Because I mean, I just bought this really expensive comforter and it's white. I don't want you in it. I don't want you near it until you
must be clean.
I'm like, I don't want to be obsessive about it.
Maybe it's just I don't know, but literally my husband is a painter. Okay. He paints. Yes. Now in his mind of the contractor spectrum,
he's the cleanest.
Painting is the cleanest. It is the most elite. It is the most pristine, whatever.
Sure.
He's currently painting kitchen cabinets with oil-based enamel, which is sticky. It's like oil paint on a canvas.
And spraying it.
But he's actually not spraying it, but either way, it's sticky and gross. And the things that you have to use to clean up after you is like turpentine type stuff. It's not literally turpentine, but
it's
paint thinner. And so he comes home. He's rather white from being doing this all day long. And everybody's going to bed. And I'm like, are you not going to shower? Like, you're dirty. You know what I mean? Look at your hands. And he's like, I already did. I mean, he's getting defensive. And I'm like, why do I even have to bring this up?
I don't want your oily body in my bed.
Obvious to me.
Please don't bring your
oily. And you've done physical labor. I get you were inside a rich person's home all day.
It doesn't mean that you're not sweaty.
But you're perhaps, and you were you're in their kitchen. You're on your hands and knees on the floor. Stop it.
You're filth. Get it out.
And he's like so irritated that I was saying it.
I'm like, well, because it's like, I am not a child.
His eyes were rolling like, ugh.
It's like having a giant baby.
Oh my God.
Yeah. And Daryl's like,
Make me a bitch.
I don't know why, but it's like lately, well, maybe because we're alone and we have nothing to deflect off of, but I'm just like,
no distractions.
I'm just like, you don't have to shut the door anymore. Like, there's nobody here. Please don't shut me into my own room like a prisoner.
Oh, the bedroom door.
Yeah. And he's like, I forget. And so then.
Well, it's a habit.
It is a habit. So it takes 21 days to break a habit.
Is that right?
Yeah, that's the truth. And so every day I have to go, and he's like, we have this dumb little sound square off. But he brought me coffee and I was still sleeping. And I woke up and I'm like, oh, how sweet, I have coffee. And I look up and the door's shut. I'm all,
I'm trapped again.
And he's like, I didn't want you to wake up. And I'm like, but you brought me coffee. You want me to wake up.
Otherwise, what, is it supposed to sit here and get cold I rise? And then I could be like ringing my bell. Jeeves, I need a heat up.
I feel so bad because.
Well, not to mention the fact that your house is ginormous.
Do you know how many women or people in general would love it if their partner brought them coffee every day.
I mean, yes, I wouldn't. I'm not one of them.
I know. And so when I tell them,
I know you like it. They're like, it's very sweet.
They're like, just shut up about your stupid love life.
Right?
I'm like, I know. Like, I said, look, I'm not.
The woe-isms so of life.
Trust. I don't like
complaining. He shut the door when he brought me, when he served me. Oh my God.
I don't want to complain. Jerk. I don't want to complain about it because I know they're like, well, my husband just slaps me every morning. But I'm so glad that you're disappointed about your door being shut.
No.
I mean, he kicked the dog downstairs, but you know, whatever. Oh, my husband, he just left the children to their own devices while I was ill with COVID.
I know. I mean, literally, this reminds me of my girlfriend I was talking to the other day. I was in her office and she was had her lunch and it was like this perfect little, like one of those little meal kits with real food. Oh, and it was like heated up and it was like, it looked so good. Yeah. And I'm like, God, Veronica, how do you have time to do all of that? And she has two kids, by the way. And she's like, well, David does it for me every morning. And so like, I'm like, what? Fuck, really? She's like, yeah, he does all of that. Like he makes the kids' lunches. He makes my coffee. He makes my lunch.
And then she makes you come home and be mad, right?
And I'm like, no, not, well, I was like, if I could even get an iota of that, like anything, I'm literally running around sweating by 6:30.
Oh God, that would
be so crazy.
Because
I have so much shit to do in the morning.
Yes.
Yeah.
A lot of it also is we're control freaks.
Yeah, that's
true. A lot of it is control freaky.
100%.
Like, Daryl will come in. He's like, was there anything I can do? And I'm like,
yeah, Jerry you know, said, like, well, I would help you if you'd let me. But every time I try, you're like, get out of my way.
Literally the same. Yeah. So I don't know if I mentioned it. But we're, like I said, we did flooring and all that stuff.
You've been doing home renovations bit by bit.
But the thing is his daughter's coming in June with her, with his, with the grandchildren. She has two. And so we want, you know, I know Daryl wanted that. He wants that room done.
So they can have a guest room. So
they have a place to stay and it's comfortable for them.
Totally.
All the things. Well, I asked Daryl to take a week off so that we could do the downstairs living area. I said, I want to paint. I want to put in, you know, furniture. I want to fix our bookcase because we want it to extend to the ceiling and we want to add, make it look like a built-in. I'm like, so it's not a lot of work, but it's work that I want to get done.
And he's, you can't, like, do it while you're working 5 days a week.
No. And he goes, okay, no problem. So he comes out and he goes, okay, so I took 2 days off. Oh. I took Friday and Monday off. So we'll have 4 days, except that one of the days is Easter.
Oh, okay.
And we had plans.
Well, no.
So we had,
need five consecutive days.
I wanted a week. I wanted Monday through Friday.
Yeah. So
we can do all the things.
And then the weekend stuff is always anyway.
Yeah. Because it's like there was so many other things I had to get. We had to go to the dump and we had to.
Well, during the week is like, no one, everybody's doing life. Yeah. Like they're either going to school, they're working,
you can get stuff done. Yeah. So anyway, that did not happen. And so we were sitting there on Friday night, his first day, and he ripped out all the carpet. He did everything upstairs. So he did all that stuff. And he ordered all the flooring, like, a month before.
So everything was coming.
We're going to get it. Da, da, da. And I said, all right. And I'm not saying anything. And finally he goes, aren't you excited? I'm like, well, you know, I am. And he goes, what do you mean? I go, here's the thing. I asked you to take a week off. You didn't take a week off. You took 2 days off. And one of them is an actual holiday for you.
Right.
I go, number one. Number two, you have spent all of your time doing the bedroom when I wanted to do
the downstairs.
And I said, that's not happening. And I go, and I understand that it's important. I really do. But that was not the plan.
And now we're invested in this upstairs project.
And that's what I said. And we spent all this money to get the flooring. Someone's coming up to help you on Saturday. So we're
not going to stop and be like, oh yeah, you want to do the downstairs. Never mind.
So now all of these 2 whole days that you took off are now focused on the bedroom. And if you notice when you got here, this place is in disarray. Like everything is still everywhere.
To you, yes, but it's not that bad. But I understand if I lived here, I'd feel that way.
I feel like I'm in a welfare recipient home right now. our entryway is covered in things.
Right. I'm wondering what our listeners are thinking right now. They're like, oh, the troubles.
No, but so then, you know what? It's marriage.
I get it.
It's relationship.
100%.
So I'm like, and the thing is Stephanie, you know. I'm very clear what I want.
Right.
I don't.
And by the way,
sugarcoat anything.
Everybody probably already knows this. But my sister versus me, she's very kind when she asks for things.
Initially.
Yes. Right. I mean, so you're very reasonable about it.
I just said this is what I want.
I don't ask for anything nicely. I'm like, do it. Yes. Everything's a command when it comes to Stephanie.
Well, you know what? I might have to start taking after you, actually.
Well, it doesn't work out quite well when, I mean, one likes to be whipped in the back at like a mule and told to move and do it yesterday.
A work mule. But anyway, so I said, but you didn't do any of that. I said, so now here we are. So I might get some paint on the walls Monday when we go buy it in the morning, right, and then paint it Monday. And then guess what? You get to go to work on Tuesday.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to be trying to paint a 30-foot ceiling in the middle of the house. And he's sitting there quietly looking down.
Like, shit.
Well, yes and no, but he's just like...
Or annoyed.
And I said, look...
Little of both.
Please understand that I know how important it is for you to have your daughter have a comfortable place.
Yes.
I go, but this became the Daryl show. Immediately upon the days off, I'm like, you were like, I'm getting this bedroom done. He's like, let's paint it. Let's do all this. And I'm like, I don't want to fucking paint the bedroom.
Right.
I don't give a shit that the walls are blue.
We have till June, by the way.
Yeah. I'm like, I don't care.
Yeah.
And so now he starts to see that he has completely taken over this entire week.
Right.
These two whole days that he took off.
That are now nothing to do with what you wanted it for.
Nothing.
Right.
And so now... And the guilt starts to set in. Mm. And I said, look, I'm not mad. I'm just disappointed because I was kind of hoping that we'd get a lot of stuff done.
Yeah.
And now nothing's gotten done.
Right.
So he stayed up till 10 o'clock on Saturday painting. And he
so reminds me of something.
He bought a sprayer to spray the paint on. He goes, this is so much more efficient. I'm like, it isn't actually. But okay, because it's a baby one.
If it makes you feel better, then.
Yeah, it's not an industrial one that Jerry has.
It's the homeowner one. We've seen them.
And it's tiny.
And actually, we were like, these are cute if you're doing a bathroom or something, you know.
But not that room.
Well, no.
So he comes in and goes, well, what do you think? I go, well, I think it looks like somebody spray painted our walls. And he's like, it'll look better tomorrow. And I'm like, I don't think so. I go, I think we need to hand paint this. And he's like, okay. Yeah, and we did. And it worked out much better.
Well, honestly... But yes, professional painters do both. When they spray a wall, they back roll it. And I'm the back roller. That's how I know.
Well, that's exactly what we did.
It's hard work.
So anyway, it got all done. And I said, you know, it's 9:30 at night. You need, and on Easter Sunday, I'm like, you need to stop. It's done. It's done. And he goes, no, I'm not going to stop until it's done. And I'm like, look.
I'm going to prove to you. Exactly. I'm not an asshole. And this is for naught.
Oh, yes. And that's exactly what happened.
Yeah.
And it got done.
It's funny when those things happen. That reminds me of when we moved, just really quick story. It was very, very similar. We were moving, and I don't know about you. You haven't had to do it in a while, but when you move, there's so much pressure when you have to move, and you know it's coming, and all of the things that have to do. It's a huge undertaking. Well, thankfully, my husband found a place for us to move because that was the biggest issue. We live in California.
It's hard
very
to find
difficult
rentals.
To find rentals. Yes. Yep, and that are decent, that you're willing to live in, and that you can afford, all of the above. So I hadn't seen this place, but I was so thrilled with the neighborhood in general. Yeah. I knew where it was. And I was like, I don't care what it is. And as long as it's not a shed, I'm good. Let's make it work.
Yes.
Well, when we got the keys and we went and looked, I was mortified. I couldn't believe. I cried. I was like, we have to live here.
Oh my God. Did we just step down?
I can't bring my child into this. And we're supposed to move in tomorrow.
You're like, when I told you I didn't want it to be a shed.
Well, he hadn't seen it either. That's how desperate we were. We literally signed the lease, paid the money, got the keys, and had not seen the inside of the house.
Oh my
we had
God.
Seen the outside, but not the inside. So I digress. Ultimately, we made arrangements to stay at our place for a week longer because we could not move into this place the way it was. Mm. And now the pressure's really on because I'm like, okay, we were already supposed to be here. Now our current landlord's being nice and letting us stay another week for money, of course.
Of course.
But we have a week to get this place in shape. To make it livable. And that was going to be a stretch.
Oh my God.
And thank God I'm married to a painter.
So he was able to...
So one would think... Right.
Oh.
So we. So he took the week off in your example while I had to work and was going to paint the whole entire inside of the house. Now this isn't a huge job, but for a professional painter, he easily could have done this. Had it been for money, he would have had this shit done in 3 days.
Of course.
Okay. So day three, I finally go back over there to see the progress, and it looks like he had never been there.
You're like, what are you doing?
I'm like, what have you fucking been doing for 3 goddamn days? We have to move in here in 2.
And what are we supposed to do?
And nothing is done and everything. And he's like, well, you just don't know and blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, you know what? I can't. So that was the end of it. Well, I went to bed angry. The next morning, no, it was like 2 or 3 in the morning. I get up, which I always do to like pee and get a drink or whatever. Here comes, I see my husband in the kitchen having a cocktail. at 2:30 in the morning and he's got his shoes on.
What?
And I'm like, what the fuck are you doing? I thought I was hallucinating. You know, I'm like, what? Did you have to go and take something out to the trash? Like what?
What's happening?
And he was mad. He's like, nah. You know, he like basically wasn't talking. I'm like, whatever.
Okay.
Well, what I ended up finding out was after I fell asleep, he left. And painted the entire inside of that house.
So he came home and had a cocktail.
In like 9 hours.
Holy crap.
He literally painted all evening and all night until the middle of the night. And when he came back, he was so angry, but he was done and exhausted.
Hey, you know what? I appreciate it.
So I just had no idea that he had been gone. I was like, I literally slept through while you were gone all that
time?
He's
probably like, I'm going to get you.
He did. And the next day when I went over there, the whole house was painted. I'm like, oh my God. You're so like, I felt like an asshole.
Why? No, you got it done. You got what you got done, man.
It was done. So.
There you go. End scene.
Yes. He'll never forgive me for that probably.
Yeah. You know what? Every once in a while I think about it, I go, you know, I don't know if Daryl and I could survive a renovation.
We just need a cattle prod to make them do things.
Yeah. Because it's apparently. Like, you think we're control freaks. Daryl will just literally take over and not say anything.
Oh, for real?
I didn't pick up one brush the entire time. I didn't pick up one
brush. Which is weird because you're usually the one that's like doing a lot of that.
I love to paint. You do. But he was just like, absolutely not. And he didn't even say, don't touch those brushes. He's just like working so quickly. And he's just like, I'm going to prove to her that we can get it all done in 4 days. And I'm like,
I'm not an asshole.
Yeah. And I know that the guilt was killing him. Yeah. And so I'm like, all right, fine, do it. Let the guilt run through you, fool.
Well, that's the brilliance of the way you do things in your marriage is like, you don't even have to say anything. Oh God, really?
I'm such a bitch.
You let them do it. And then after the fact, point out all the reasons why this didn't go exactly the way I went, but it's fine.
That's diva. That is diva behavior right there. That is hardcore diva. In fact, today I said something. And I can't even remember what it was. And I said, I think something's wrong with me. He goes, yeah, I think you're right. I go, what's wrong with me then? And he's like, I don't know.
Yeah, shut
and
the
I'll,
fuck up.
That's what I thought. I know I'm crazy, but you don't get to call me crazy. I call me crazy. God.
Never agree with me when I say I think there's something wrong with me.
That's like saying, well, yeah, you're a little fat. No.
He would never.
Oh,
no.
My God.
But you're right. That's just how shocking it would be.
The other day I said, do you even find me sexually attractive anymore? And he looks at me, he goes, what did you say? That is
such a dumb question.
He's like, why would you say that? I go, well, you know, it's been a couple of days. He's like, God. He's like,
Jesus Lord.
I know. I just think I'm like, I just don't want things to go slack because we're alone now and we can just.
It's the opposite. Usually for most people.
I heard somebody was an empty nester and they said, yeah, our daughter moved out and we had sex in every room of the house. Like we'd never had sex before. I'm like, really? Why?
That's stupid.
And I told Daryl that I go, I don't understand. I go, I didn't suddenly get a libido the second we became empty nesters. No. I go, that's weird. And he goes, yeah, that is weird.
It just affords you more privacy.
I said, the only thing I can think is that some parents actually have respect for their children.
Absolutely.
And they don't go crazy when they have kids in the house.
Yeah.
I said, all I know is this. I go, I never want anyone to interview my children and tell them, retell their traumas of when they heard their parents.
Oh my God.
Because I know, we know that they have.
Right.
Stories.
Same.
Because we lived in little shoeboxes.
Right.
And I said.
I have very vivid traumatic memories of things that I.
Same.
Think.
And I'm like, I know all kids have those stories.
We don't.
I have one.
I don't want to know. Of our parents?
Of our father.
Ew.
I'm not.
How is it a soul person?
Because he was married to other people, Stephanie. It wasn't just our mother. Okay.
Well, so actually that one probably wouldn't bother me as much as long as it didn't involve mom.
I don't want to talk about it.
I don't want to talk about
it
either.
It's traumatizing.
It's gross.
So my point is, I told Daryl, I said, I don't even want, I go, there's only one caveat. I always maintain that we never do anything marital when they have friends over.
Oh God.
Ever.
Yeah.
But Daryl doesn't think the way I do.
Because he's a man.
Because he's a dude.
Yeah.
And so there were times where I'm like, just fine, but quick.
Yeah.
But it doesn't matter. You know, kids know. And you know, someone's child is, you know, one of our kids is probably going, God, are you fucking kidding me with this?
Oh, definitely.
And I'm like,
that
I don't
and fighting.
Want, that's true.
I've heard my daughter in the other room, Mom, really? Kelly's over. I'm like, shut the fuck up. Do you see? She could hear us.
Oh, God. It's so true. One time I was driving by one of my daughter's friends, and this was when they were like in middle school, and we drove by their house, and just because it was Orangevale and it was small,
yeah,
we drove by their house and I saw her parents in the driveway screaming fighting at each other. And I was like,
well, you have to go somewhere.
Exactly. Because I knew, well, Kenzie wasn't
ours is
there.
The garage, but yeah.
Yeah. Well, my daughter wasn't at this house, but I saw them out there and they were having a very serious discussion at the behind their truck bed.
Right.
And I was like, ah, damn.
we've all been there.
I've definitely done that.
Yeah. It's either your children hear you or your neighbors. And sometimes it's
pick your poison.
Your neighbors have to
which one
deal
is it?
With it. That's why I think sometimes my neighbor next door, Suzanne, she's so sweet. Bless her heart. But she's single. So she looks at me like with the most, girl. Like, I feel for you, girl. I'm like, yeah, you heard that last night in the garage. Sorry.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It happens.
It had to be the garage because, you know.
What are you going
to
do?
I mean, a little. And
hey, you know what? It's the people that don't fight that end up killing each other.
Right?
The people that fight get it out.
Right. I agree.
Yeah.
The people who are like, they were the best couple. We never suspected anything.
We vacationed with.
They never fought.
John and Brenda were wonderful people. We vacationed with them every summer.
We can't understand why John buried Vanessa in the backyard.
She was strangulated.
After decapitating her.
It's so strange. We don't know why he gouged her eyes out, but it's like.
So true.
They were just so nice.
Yeah.
That's why, because they never spoke.
Right.
Anyway, so speaking of TikTok really quick. You sent me a TikTok yesterday about a girl. She's like, I don't know why you guys always lose your shit, but I like eating tuna in the car. And I'm like, what?
Not just tuna, not any old tuna, but ahi tuna steak.
A big chunk
like
of
like the
tuna.
Kind you buy. Yeah. Now, if anybody's ever gone to your, you know, your.
It's like a pound.
Your seafood section. Yes. You can buy fresh ahi tuna.
You can buy a huge pile of.
And it's enough for like a whole dinner, right? For like two or three people. Usually.
And you're like, oh, look, I'm not the only one. I'm like, I can't believe what I'm seeing right now. And,
yeah.
And now.
Thank you. Thank you, person on TikTok for validating me.
Yes.
Because I just did it a long time ago before we had TikTok.
Well, please tell us the story.
Okay. So I never found it weird, but you and Paula thought it was the strangest thing.
I just thought it was strange because of the way Paula described it.
Right.
She made it sound like you were savage.
I kind of was.
Well, tell me.
But now we're all savages and it's okay. So we've accepted the fact that we are savage and it's fine. So because we've all accepted we can be whatever we want nowadays and nobody judges you.
That's right.
So back in the day, this was probably in the late 90s.
Mm-hmm.
Sushi was not what it is today.
Not here.
No, not in California.
You had to go to like San Francisco.
You had to go to San Francisco or a major metropolis.
Yeah,
you know, LA.
There were not a ton of sushi restaurants
like
in Sacramento.
No.
Yeah.
But there were one or two. Mm-hmm. And if you had been to one, then you were like, my God, this is like the best thing ever. And so then they started kind of selling that stuff in the grocery stores. Mm-hmm. So you could do your own. And I discovered this quite early. And because I have weird, I don't know what it is, but like I can't eat certain foods in front of certain people. Like if you don't like sushi or you don't like mussels or whatever it is, then I can't eat in your presence because I feel like you're judging me or you're like, it's so disgusting to you
that
you can't watch.
I got it.
So I won't do it because I can't enjoy it.
Sure.
So this was my thing because I live with a grown 5-year-old.
Who likes chicken nuggies.
Yes. Who would never eat sushi. So I went to Bel Air by myself. Bel Air is a fancy store here in Sacramento and they have all gourmet things. And they had ahi sushi grade tuna. I bought a steak. I was so excited. I bought all the things to go with it, the wasabi, the soy, and I could not wait to get home and like make it my own.
And just like,
totally enjoy it. And it's so much more affordable when you do it that way.
Oh my God.
Go to a sushi restaurant and order, you know, a donburi or whatever it's called. And it's like, you know, $30.
Yes.
But you can buy a tuna steak at the store for like $12.
Yes.
So I was just so giddy. And so I get in the car, I'm alone and I'm like, my God,
your mouth is watering.
Literally could not wait.
You're like, that's it.
I took it out. I unwrapped it. I looked around. Nobody was watching me. And I took a giant bite and it was the most satisfying thing ever. Right. I was so freaking happy. I was like, oh my God. So I told my sisters the story. They just couldn't believe that I would actually sit in my car.
It was so insane. But did you pull out the soy and the wasabi?
No.
Oh,
I was like an animal. I was literally like a rabid animal.
But then when you showed me this woman holding a sushi grade steak of tuna and was
she
eating
squirted
it.
Soy on hers.
She was doctoring hers, which is bougie, I suppose. But it's like you were just like, oh no, I was just like a large cat eating this giant fish in my car.
And yeah, so she, this TikTok I sent my sister was literally the same thing, but 20 years
like,
later.
I don't know why you guys are judging me. And I'm like, why does because think it's this weird. Because it's a little weird to eat a giant piece of raw fish in your car.
I'd love to hear the stories of people or listeners or whoever, of what you do in your, and the safety of your car.
I've told you what Daryl, he hates it so much.
In his car?
No. He, last night he goes, I saw the most
People eating.
He goes,
women.
I saw the most horrific thing yesterday. And I go, you did what? Was it a woman eating a Big Mac? Because it grosses him out beyond. He goes, no. Then he goes, where? And I go, nowhere.
I'm asking
you. And he goes, oh. He goes, no, but that's bad. And then I don't even remember what he told me. But anyway.
Somebody eating something
he
somewhere.
He hates seeing women eat in the car. Yeah. It bothers him. It's the most misogynistic thing that he has.
Well, I don't know if it's misogynistic. It's just one of those
weird. It doesn't bother him to see a man eat, but he sees a woman eat. He's like, ugh.
For some reason, he finds that like non-feminine.
All I know is that he was probably some trigger from childhood.
Perhaps.
You know what? I was watching something the other day and they said, if you really want to get into the mind of someone, if they're really pissing you off and you're squaring off, and this is good for me because I, unlike you, I can't come up with the quips that you need to cut someone down.
Yes, you can.
To the quick. Not really. That's why I always would choose violence.
Right.
Because it was just easier. It was just easier. You were the one that could slay someone to their soul with
That's
words.
True.
You know, I couldn't.
That's because so, I was always skinny and scrawny and weak. So I had to do
I was always
compensate.
So damn jealous that you could come up with something to say that would absolutely kill someone. And I'm like, I just have to hit you because it's all I've got.
And thank God because you got my mouth out of many situations.
A very good team.
Because you always, I'll end up slaying somebody with my words, somebody like you who's like, well, I don't have anything to say, so I'm just going to punch you in the mouth.
I'm like, no, you will not. My big sister's going to come and kick your ass.
And by that time, I'll already have a fat lip.
Oh my God, Stephanie, it's so true. But anyway, so she's like, if you can't come up with something to say and someone's really like, they need something, you just start staring at their eyebrows. And you just stare at them and you get like a confused look on your face.
Yeah, like
And then you just go, okay. Mm-hmm. And then you walk away. Mm-hmm. They're like, or if they say something really cruel to you and you're like, ooh, you know what, you repeat it. You go, I'm sorry, what did you say?
Yeah.
Can you repeat that? And they'll you can just go, oh, that's what I thought you said.
Yeah, let them
can
say
Can you explain
twice.
Why you said, and like literally beat it to death.
Yeah. Yeah.
And if they have to beat it to death, then suddenly they feel dumb.
Yeah.
Anyway, so just a few celeb news nuggets. And then I have something to read. It's really funny. So Christine Brown is engaged.
Are any of us surprised?
No. And you know, it's like people are in two camps. One is like, oh, this is so soon. This is so dumb. She's literally marrying the first man that she dated. And I'm like, that's kind of expected to me.
And by the way, she's in her 50s.
Kind of expected.
Don't have time to wait and do a long courtship.
When people want to get married, you seek it out.
Yeah.
And I think that this person, David, is actually a good match. He's a widower.
I agree.
There's no crazy ex-wife. There's baggage, but
there's
it's
no baggage in that sense where you're
not dealing with you know, you're not doing anything like that with the ex.
Right.
His daughter's an adult and she fully approves. And so,
you know, Christine's children.
Christine's children like him as well. But they're like, you realize that Cody and Christine, first of all, were not even intimate for almost 10 years.
So that was so dead.
It was very intermittent. Number two, she's been legally free of him for 2 years.
Correct.
Like a long time.
Yeah.
We don't know how long they've been dating. Why would we know? We wouldn't know.
I mean,
we're
going to assume that just because she didn't tell us publicly.
So the show shows her moving away and then 3 months later, she's like, oh, I'm dating. And
it could have been happening all along.
6 months later, they're engaged. It's like, it's only been 6 months. Like, it has not been 6 months.
Okay. And even if it has, I feel like a woman of that age, if you know, what are we waiting for? I mean,
this woman was on the hunt probably a year before she left. She lost a crap ton of weight.
Yes.
She started taking care of herself. She had a different attitude. She had a bounce in her step because she knew she was out.
Yes.
And she's like, she
had something to look forward to.
She worked on
finally.
Herself. And her daughters who were living in Utah were completely helping her.
Totally.
Not to get rid of, I just mean, they were like, yes, mom, monogamy,
supportive.
Whatever.
Yeah.
And the other thing is, I think that when she started looking amazing on the show before she ever left, I think she had officially decided she was leaving the cult. I think that she was
everything.
Her mom was helping her kind of deprogram her a little bit, trying to explain to her that, you know, monogamy is actually preferable for,
and it's fine
for you, yeah. You know, and it's okay. So to me, it's like, this has actually been a really long journey, and yeah, she might, and we don't know that this was the first guy she dated.
We don't.
We have no idea. I think it's a great match, and I'm with you. When you're in your 50s, if you're in, if you want to get married again, you go for it.
I'm sorry, but at my age, let's just say that I had, I would never be in the exact situation, sure. But let's say that I had gotten out of a terrible relationship, yeah. And it had been years, mm-hmm. And I meet someone that I'm, at my age, if I meet someone that I want to marry, yeah. I am so knowing that that's the right thing
that's
to
right.
do.
Absolutely.
When you're in your 50s, you're
you
not
are
like,
not a dumb woman.
No, right. You already know. You yes. know, you know, you know.
Yes.
So if this is it for her and she 100% knows, I believe it, I trust yeah. it, and
especially
I'm happy for her.
And her daughters, I think Aspen introduced them. So she already knows the family.
Yeah, she did. He did. He was yeah. not a stranger.
No.
Was,
and he, so to me, known. I'm just so pleased. And you know, you can, I've seen fans of the show or whatever comment like, oh, you know, I don't know about this. He just wants, you know, fame or whatever. And I'm like, no, fools.
Bullshit.
Stop it. No, this is amazing.
And he's barely been in an, I mean, he's only on whatever she posts him on.
That's right.
He's not going and doing interviews or podcasts. He's not doing any of that.
None of the things. And to me, it's like.
And we've seen people do that.
Oh, yeah.
Where they get with a pseudo celeb, you know, a B or C, D. Lister, yes. And the next thing you know, they're doing their own shit. And you're like, oh God.
You're like, okay.
This man is not doing that.
No, he has his own business. He's living
living in life, and he's happy that he met someone he can be with. That's
and of course, I immediately start judging the engagement ring.
Well, we all do.
Like, immediately.
I did too. I think I took a screenshot so I could blow it up.
I did too. So I was like,
well,
okay.
They're
so
not going to be uber wealthy. It's
so
okay.
She finally showed us the ring. It's not even about the size. Here's the thing that I didn't
like. Is it a cluster?
No. It's a solitaire, probably just under a carat. If I can say. Oh, you saw it, right?
Yeah, I saw it. It wasn't a super close up.
It's an oval, but with points on both ends. Yeah. Whatever cut that is. I don't know. I'm happy for her. But more than anything, honestly, I'm just happy she's out of that fucking cult.
Yeah, I know.
Second, Christina Aguilera came out with a lube. Did you
know
this?
No. In fact, I saw it on your agenda, and I was like, oh, I had no idea.
She came out with a lube. This news just went sailing under the, because there's just been so many other big news stories, so no one's really talking about it. But I found it because I love Christina Aguilera.
I do too.
She's 42.
Yeah.
I can't even believe that my favorite singer from when we were all young.
It's
she
42.
Was 16 years old when I started following her. She's 42, and I'm like, holy crap. She came out with a lube. She's like, well, I know my vagina really well now. She's doing the Madonna thing a little bit, and I'm not a big fan of
that.
Well,
I mean, it's
the Gwyneth
Paltrow thing, yes. The Kourtney Kardashian thing.
And I'm cool with products that they're like, you know, this is something that we need, blah, blah, blah. And
to
I'm like,
keep it real.
How about this? How about, because I read all the press, I read the interview, and I did all of that. And she's like, yeah, this lube is really great for women, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, why don't you just be honest and say, I'm perimenopausal, guys.
Yeah.
The genie in the bottle singer.
At 42, though?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay.
You could be in perimenopause for a decade.
Oh, okay.
And so she's like, if she just said, vages sometimes dry up when you're in perimenopause.
Yeah.
Like, if you want to be graphic or if you want to be opening honest.
Keep it real.
Be really clear why you made a lube. It's not because you're, you know, having a lot of orgies and you need something. You know,
right.
you are using this because unfortunately for you, you're struggling with that area.
Right.
And this is great. It's a water-based whatever.
And many women do. It's super common. I don't think it's a secret.
It is very
anymore.
Common. And so it's like, but be clear. Stop acting like you're 18. You're not.
Right.
You're a woman, a grown-ass woman, post-children, and you're struggling.
Yeah.
And so you created this thing.
Yeah.
Great. Wonderful.
Right?
Just say it.
And you have a platform to sell it.
Just
so,
say it.
Yeah, I agree.
It's like, I remember I was watching a woman. She goes, nobody wants to talk about it, but you realize that Jennifer Aniston and Jennifer Lopez are in menopause, right?
They have to be.
They're in their 50s.
Yeah.
They're older than me. And then they've got to be.
Yeah, oh, for sure.
It's not a dirty secret. It's what freaking happens.
Yeah, it's just,
so
well,
anyway.
It's chemistry. It's biology. You cannot stop it.
It's like post-menses, whatever. But, you know, Cheryl and I were talking about that, and I was reading something, and they said, yeah, that apparently men, you can kind of, their testosterone kind of fluctuates quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
And if they don't have a lot of sex, their testosterone can go down.
Yeah, that makes sense.
And I didn't know that. And I was like, I just found it fascinating. I go, but isn't it fascinating that these are just little tidbits that they've known? And I go, we know nothing about women's health. We know nothing about hormones.
Well, I think we've been talking about a lot of, about women's health in general. And it's been coming, I think it's just a trend right now, but women talking about the brutality of the physical exams and the testing and stuff that we have to go through
it's just a little pinch. It's not just
a pinch. Yeah. You're pinching like the inside of an organ.
I've had my children both have female procedures for birth control with no anesthesia. Nothing. And they're like,
you couldn't even get near a man's penis with any of those things.
And, and they both said, I will never do that again. And I said, no, if you want to do it again, you find a doctor who will anesthetize you before you do it. And she's like, good luck finding one.
It's true. It's very true. Said,
well, we will just search.
And I really hope that this trend that we're seeing where women are exposing, you know, what that looks like.
Yes.
Because we've gotten so used to, especially women of our age,
suffer.
We've suffered forever. We just like, that's just the way it is.
And it's
you know,
not.
And we never even thought of an alternative.
Nothing should be painful.
I mean, honestly, anatomically created for most of our stuff is inside, right? And so, and these things that you have to do to
no big deal, guys.
Preventative health,
I'm
which
just
is
going to take a biopsy.
Thank you.
With nothing.
Yeah, I mean, like, I even mammograms forever were like
very
painful. It was something so painful. Yeah. Women avoided it and died of breast cancer.
I would rather die than get my boobs. I mean, it's so true.
Yeah. So, I mean, you know, it's similar to dentistry, you know, where it's like back in the day, going to dentist was such a traumatic thing that many of us now are like, I cannot go to the fucking dentist without a Valium, without gas, without whatever. You know, we will do anything to avoid going through that.
And what's
funny
is and dentists are like, it's not like that anymore. We're like, I don't believe
you. I don't believe you. I don't fucking believe you.
I don't believe you.
Yeah.
But it's pseudo true, but yeah, it's difficult. Anyway. Okay. So I found this really weird thing and I thought it was so funny. And we'll end with this. Apparently hamsters always die dramatically.
Oh God.
Hamsters don't just die.
Okay.
They're very fragile creatures.
They're similar creatures that I told you I've had. Birds that have died in traumatic ways.
Yes. Okay. We have to share. But so I was like, I'm like, I have heard that hamsters are a bit drama queens when it comes to their demise.
Okay.
They're a little suicide-y.
They're super cute.
They're adorable, but I don't want one. They bite.
Well, I've had one. My children have had them. Oh, yes. Okay. Not myself.
So here's a couple of stories and then you can tell me some of yours if this triggers.
We were never permitted to have pets for the most part.
Stephanie, in a million years, I'm so grateful that mom didn't let us have hamsters.
We weren't allowed to have any pets.
Well, we had dogs.
Sometimes.
But I never allowed my children to have a rat. They're like, we want a rat. I'm like, in your dreams.
No, my daughter had a hamster and I'll tell you the story, but go ahead.
So the first one, I popped a balloon and it died of a heart attack.
Oh,
I know, right? This happens a lot. I've read a lot of heart attacks.
Well, they have teensy little hearts and they beat really fast.
Well, apparently they're just very anxious creatures.
Yeah, they are.
This one said,
they're rodents.
My parents left me alone, so I let my hamster run free. And why did it run directly into the fireplace?
Oh my God.
It killed itself. Oh. This one said, mine jumped off the dresser and directly onto the fan on my table.
Oh my God. God.
This other one said, my hamster disappeared for months. It casually came out from under the refrigerator, missing hair, looked up at me, and died.
Oh my God.
I'm not kidding.
He's like, I'm free.
My sibling and I had one. It escaped from its cage and was missing for days. It ran out from under the couch right in front of my mom vacuuming.
Oh, for God's sake.
She sucked it up and it died.
I'm telling you.
This one
is so sad.
This one's kind of, it's okay. I mean, I shouldn't be laughing at any of these, but.
Well, no.
I won the raffle to take the class hamster home for the summer.
Oh, no.
First weekend, I'm cleaning his cage and he's rolling around in the grass in his plastic ball under a big shady fig tree. The fool rolled itself out into the sun. The plastic ball became a giant magnifying glass and he was dead.
Oh, my God.
In seconds. He burned.
Oh my God.
I was like, what the fuck? But everybody said hamsters are low key suicidal.
Well,
they do crazy shit and they kill themselves all the time.
I think they're like probably close to being instinctual. Like they do have a brain, but it's very limited in its capacity.
It's primitive.
Yeah. So
they're just like they're like the lemmings that fling themselves from cliffs.
I'm telling you. So my daughter had a hamster when she was in junior high, and it was so cute, and she loved it. And she was around that age where she would go and stay at friends for the weekend. Mm-hmm. One friend. She had one friend she was allowed to go to.
Sure.
And so what the house we lived at the time was on the river. And so we had from time to time, not, I don't want to say rats, but mice. And it wasn't all right. the time because I had cats. So there was never really, we never got infested or anything like that.
No, but you're by the river.
But you're by the river and things will meander into your house from time to time. Ooh. So Jerry happens to have an extreme aversion for mice in general or rats or anything like that.
Same.
And he's not really skittish about most anything, but those for some reason are like, that's where he draws the line.
Sure.
So we hadn't seen one, a mouse or anything like that in months, maybe even a year. It'd been a long time since anything like, but he was always paranoid. So we lost the hamster. I lost the hamster. Okay. I had the hamster out because I believe I was cleaning the cage. And it popped out of my hand because like you said, they fling
around.
Yes. And so I was like, you know what, whatever. How far can it go?
It's a tiny little place.
It was like 1,000 square feet house. Yes. It was so small. So I'm like, I'll find it. He helped me look for it. We looked everywhere. We couldn't find it. We figured it was hiding because
it'll come out.
We had cats. Yeah. And it's like, I'm not going out and getting killed immediately. So it was maybe an hour. It wasn't like this went on for days. It really didn't. And we were in the kitchen and all of a sudden he's like, rat. You know, he thought he saw a rat and he picked it up and grabbed it. I'm like, don't grab it with your bare hands. My God, right? It could be have rabies or whatever. And because we lived on the river, he opened the door and he threw it into the water as it was like slow motion. It was like, whoa, as it's going through the air, we both make eye contact with it. And it was the hamster.
No,
it was not a rat. It was not a mouse. It was the hamster and it hit the water. It didn't even like go under like you would think.
It was dead immediately.
It literally just like flipped over on its back and it was like, I mean, I think it had a heart attack. Too. Thank God. Because the thought of it drowning, I mean, Sacramento River is like a freaking ocean.
Oh my God.
It's huge and it flows really fast.
Oh my God.
I never told my daughter to this day. She has no idea. I told her we lost it. And that we never found it.
You did lose it. And you didn't find it.
I couldn't bear to tell her that Jerry threw it in the river.
Stephanie.
It was so horrible. To this day, it
you know what? At least it died quickly and it didn't suffer.
I mean, but it was just
the worst. They die of heart attacks so fast.
That's what it was. I'm convinced that it did die of a heart attack, I hope. And then there was one other thing, and this I never actually witnessed, but my daughter had a parakeet. She had two, and they were new. She had just gotten them very recently. And she, you know, you cover up bird cages at night.
Yeah, so they can sleep.
A blanket or a towel, whatever, right? So she, and this, my child was like 14 at the time. Okay. So they are on, they're barely human at that age. They sleep a lot. They're dirty. They have zits, and they're just generally unpleasant.
They're just trying to be, they're just trying to exist.
Correct. And so the next morning, my daughter comes out. She's lounging on the couch, doing nothing on her phone. And I'm like, what's going on? She goes, I think my bird is dead. I'm like, excuse me?
What?
She's like, yeah, I'm pretty sure one of the birds died. And I'm like, how do you know? And did you look? What are you talking about? She's like, well, I don't know. I heard a bunch of ruckus at like 2 a.m. under the cage. And I didn't know what was happening. I opened my eyes and I just heard this. She goes, and then I heard thunk, like a thud.
No.
And I'm like, and you didn't turn the light on and see what was going on?
You didn't investigate?
Like, I was so tired, Mom. I just figured I'd deal with it in the morning.
Wow.
I was like, and you still haven't, it was like 10 a.m. at this point.
And you still haven't looked?
No, I figured I would just tell you because I didn't want to go see.
What the hell?
So I go in. Sure as shit. This bird is dead, flat on its back, hard as a rock, little feet in the air and everything. And I'm like, well, what happened? She goes, I think he choked or something. I don't know. Cause he was
what?
Like, he was like making this weird noise and then he hit the ground and that's all I know. And I'm like, Lauren, Ashley, I'm like, oh my God.
So the other bird didn't kill it?
No, we don't. We'll never know.
Wow.
Because Lauren did not bother to look to see because she couldn't be bothered. She was exhausted.
Do you still have that other bird?
I do.
That bird's like, I have seen some things.
Yeah.
And I'm going to mind my business. Because
I know. You never know. We don't really know what happens.
Wow.
But yeah, I mean, you would think a little creature like that would die peacefully or quietly and you would just discover them. But no.
This thing was being dramatic.
Something happened.
Maybe it was part hamster.
I don't know.
Jesus.
Well,
all right.
Shocking that my child had no interest in finding out what was going on. She's like, well, what was I going to do? Give it CPR? There was no way I was going to save it. I knew it was gone.
Heartless.
She's my daughter.
True. Although you're far more
with animals.
Passionate. Oh my God.
Yeah. I'll take an animal over a person.
You don't even
day.
Want a worm to suffer. You're like, it's in the range. Save it. It's draining.
I almost saved one the other day. It was raining so hard and it was just struggling in this puddle. I'm like, well, I don't know what to do because I can't touch you.
Just get a little shovel and place you over
like,
here.
Like, there's no dirt around.
Do you know how many times I've saved worms? I've literally picked them up and put them in dirt. I'm like, go free, live.
Yeah.
Make some casings.
I know. Is that what they do?
Well, I don't know. Whatever. I'm just.
Yeah. How do they get stuck in puddles? But then I was like, you know, there's probably
I think they're attracted to the rain and they come out. They're like,
they
oh.
are. Well, they like moist things, right? Because that's why they live yes. in the dirt.
Ugh. Yeah. Gross. Enjoy your lives.
I know.
I've come across worms that were way too large. And I'm like, you know
oh,
what?
Same.
You're almost human size. I don't want to deal with you.
Yeah, I can't.
I've seen those. There's nothing in Australia that I want to experience
right?
at all.
But everything they have is
everything
gross.
Everything there wants to kill you or eat you, you know? And so
even
they,
their bees are huge. They have like those hornets and stuff.
Those significantly huge worms. They're like yeah. 2 feet long. I'm like, what is this?
And spiders.
Why do these exist?
I don't know.
Why is it prehistoric
and why are
world?
They all there?
And they're in Australia of all places. What it's
is
like
the
a
deal?
Cursed land. I don't know, but I have no interest.
And they have sharks that are like huge.
Man-eaters. People, and they're like, oh, it's that the people are so nice and, you know, it's beautiful there. And I'm like, I believe you. I will read a book about it.
Yeah.
I'm never going there.
And it's just so damn far. Because you know what? My husband has this thing. He's always wanted to go there.
Oh.
Probably because he's an ocean person.
By all means, go.
And the Great Barrier Reef's, Weef.
The Weef is there. Let's go to the Weef.
We want to go to the Great Barrier Reef.
Okay.
Yeah, so yeah, I think that's why. But yes. I mean, I'm like, that's just too far away.
You know what?
Away.
I would love to see the Great Barrier Reef as well. But I'm not going. There are sharks. That is their land.
I know.
I sent you a TikTok the other day about this idiotic family on a tiny little boat, on a little vessel
oh, God.
Out in Cape Cod.
Yeah.
Where they had Jaws filmed. And this monster of a great white shark. It was the biggest shark I've seen some amateur film.
Right.
Goes, look at the size of this thing. And somebody goes, he could turn that boat over. And they're like, you're damn right he could. I'm like, and you are just staring at it. And this shark is watching them. He's not even swimming. He's looking at them.
Like,
he's like, I think I could take it. And I'm
contemplating.
Like, you fools are dumb.
Not doing it.
So dumb. I'm like, I would be out of there. I'd be like, turn on that fucking boat.
Didn't we, was it you that we were talking about doing the shark experience out at the Farallon Islands?
Stephanie, our mother wanted to do it with me.
Oh, that's right.
She's like, Jamie, we can go in November.
I'm like, are you sure it was our mother? Because
yes.
I can't imagine our mother.
I said, I always thought it'd be fun to get on the boat, go to the Farallons, watch the great whites feed. And because they breed out there too.
They do.
And they're big out there.
Huge.
Because they're the ones that end up in Mexico.
Well, supposedly these sharks come and go from this area.
Yeah, the Farallons is their breeding ground.
Yeah.
And then they go to Mexico where it's warmer.
And all the scientist people like tag them and then so they see the ones that return.
Yes.
Yeah, they
and
come
I've
and go.
Always wanted to do it.
Me too.
And mom's like, I'll go with you. And I'm like, you will? Because Daryl's like, hell no. And I said, okay. I said,
Mr. Fisherman, Mr. Outdoorsman?
Well, he has a different take on it. He's like, first of all, Jamie, it's the bay.
Yeah.
It is tumultuous in November.
It is.
It's
actually always tumultuous.
It's like
in
the
my
choppiest
opinion.
Of the times because yeah. it's winter. So the waves are huge. And the boat they use is the old San Francisco Giants promo boat. It's
yeah.
a tugboat and it's not very big. So it's not dangerous per se, but it's not a giant.
You're not
yacht.
On a, yeah.
And I'm like, yeah, but you can literally be on the top level.
Yeah.
You can pay like a certain amount of money and be at the top floor and just look down. And
yeah,
some people get in cages and all the things.
Oh, God.
And he's like, well, you go on your own. I'm not going. So I was starting to arrange all this. And I'm like, Mom, you know, we're going to go in November. It sells out really fast. So, and it's a very short period of time.
Yeah.
Because they leave.
Right.
And so whatever. And I
they
go.
They migrate. Yes.
I go, but here's the thing. If anything happens, we have to be able to swim to shore.
Are you kidding?
No. And I said, we can make it. But it's one of those
things.
Were
you joking with her?
I was not.
Oh, my God.
And I said, but we have to have a contingency plan because I'm not going to be one of these fools just floating around in the water.
Waiting to be rescued.
We're making a beeline to the shore because it's right along the shoreline. We can make it, but you have to. She's like, all right, all right, all right.
Are you joking?
I am not joking. And so finally, but it's an all-day excursion.
Yeah.
You have to be there at like 5 in the morning.
Never in a million
years. They feed
years.
You and then they bring you back at, at
While
the
you're
dark.
Throwing
in
up
darkness.
From seasickness. Yeah.
Yeah. And so Daryl's like, I can't even believe what I'm listening to
I am really shocked right now. I didn't realize you guys took it that seriously.
And I said, I go, well, we have I have a date reserved for like the 12th of November or something like that. And I said, but it's really expensive for, and back then it was really expensive. And I said, but we're going to do it. And he's like, I'm without words. I can't believe you and your mother are going to go on a boat.
The two
to the Farallon Islands.
Prima donna people I've ever known. To see
great white sharks.
I mean.
It's like all the things.
Right?
So eventually I came to my senses and I told mom.
I was going to say, have you been possessed?
No. And I told mom and I said, you know what? Our family, like many families in the world, we have the rarest of luck or the rarest of situations. Every time I'm involved in something I've never done, they go, you know, we've never had this happen before.
Indeed.
It's going to be written on my gravestone.
It should be. All of us.
And like the time when we came back from Boston and it took us forever to get home.
Right.
And we were mid-flight and we were hitting Utah and Daryl's like, oh, we're home free. And I said, I don't believe it.
Why did you say that?
And then the pilot goes, well, this has never happened before. And Daryl looks at me, he goes, what the fuck? And I go, I'm telling you, I'm cursed.
I'm telling you.
You'll have the most amazing adventures of your life, but it's going to be harrowing. It's going to be harrowing if you're with the Campos girl.
Oh my God, so true.
I told her, I said, mom, you know what? We just don't have the privilege of doing things like this because something's going to happen.
Without consequence.
Something's going to happen.
Yeah.
She's like, you know, you're right.
She's God.
Like, and I don't want to swim.
Thank you.
And I'm like,
I'd be like the hamster. I'd hit the water and have a heart attack. That'd
I said, listen, here's the thing. I would, and I told her, I said, I'd leave you behind because I'm not going to die. I'm swimming.
You can hold on to my leg and I'll drag you.
Nope.
But
I said, I'm swimming for my life and I'm going to make it. But I, God hold you, Godspeed, because I won't be saving you.
Seriously.
So yeah, that was the end of that. So it's the most adventurous thing never was.
Right? Well, we'll have to think of a new adventurous thing because
we will find something exciting.
Yeah, I don't think mom's physically able to do that kind of thing anymore. Okay, before we go, can we talk about I know we're not sports people listeners.
Oh, I know.
But you and I are sports people.
Yes.
And can we please just briefly discuss the game last night? Yes. Sacramento Kings versus the Golden State Warriors.
Oh my God. It was so fun.
Playoff game.
It was amazing.
Huge. It's been 17 years since our team, the Sacramento Kings, has been to a playoff.
And they won their first game right out the gate at home.
So, right. And if you've been watching all the hubbaloo all week, you know, they, as excited as Kings fans were, no one actually thought they would win.
Well, realistic. It's we're literally competing against the reigning champions.
They've won five championships in 8 years or 9 years.
And so. I think four in a row or something.
Right.
Insane.
They are ridiculous. Yeah. They are so great.
Super stacked.
Yeah. So they won last night by 1 point.
It was amazing.
It was one of the most exciting games I have watched in any sport in a long, long, long time.
It felt so good.
I was screaming like a crazy person last night in my home. Really out.
It was great.
It was so much fun. So I'm really, really excited. It's a huge turning point for our team, for our city.
I'm so happy.
Yeah,
and we finally play again tonight at home again.
So again,
I'm so excited.
Very excited. And
Tyler called me yesterday and he said, mom, did you watch the game? And I said, yeah, I did watch the game.
Like people who don't watch sports watch the game.
And he goes, the Kings won, mom. And I said, I know. And I said, you know what? And it reminded me actually when they won, I told Daryl, I said, I feel like I should dig out Tyler. Tyler has a Kings jersey from when he was a boy.
I have a Mike Bibby jersey from the playoffs.
I don't know if it was
17 years ago.
Yeah. I don't know if it was Bibby or Weber that he had, but he has one.
Both
and he
very
was like,
significant.
He's like, I thought of that too. I said, I'm going to go dig it out. Yeah. I will go find it and I will.
I know.
Yeah, I don't know what we'll do with it, but I said, I will find it.
It's just fun to be nostalgic.
Oh, we were big Kings fans when they came.
Oh my gosh. So I've always been a fan, but it's just, it's really hard to be a fan of a team that just sucks.
Oh, you mean like the Raiders? Yeah. I completely get it. I completely understand.
Well, and in the difference between the NBA and the NFL is the NBA, there are so many teams. You know, with the NFL, we're it's a little smaller league, so your team will play and they will be on TV and you will see them.
Sure.
Versus if you suck in the NBA,
you're not
going to be on TV, or if you are, it's only when you're playing another
local team
that's really good.
True.
Yeah, like the Lakers or something, you know, or the Bulls or someone amazing. So very exciting time.
I'm so
even
excited.
If you don't watch sports.
It's a great
It has been so much fun.
It has been fun.
Yes. And we finally have a worthy stadium in our Golden in our One's city. Beautiful. It's beautiful. Yes, I agree. We've never had anything decent here that we could be proud of until now.
It was funny because we were watching it and I said, you know what I really like is that those diehard Kings fans who have been going to these games when nobody was there.
Yes.
And they have.
How satisfying for them.
They practically have floor seats.
Yes.
And these are very average people.
Oh my gosh.
And watching them standing up and given
the best,
given the players the business, and they're all in their gear. It kind of reminds me of major league or minor league.
Oh yeah,
where those people are, they never miss a game, and they're all in, and doesn't matter. They don't care
if they're horrible.
And then when they finally become winning,
somebody, yeah,
they're surrounded by people, and it's like it makes even better.
It's so good.
I told Daryl, I said, I cannot tell you how satisfying it is to see an average Sacramento fan sitting floor level,
finally having their dream having come true.
They're finally getting what they've been waiting for 15 years or however long it's been. And not a celeb in sight because...
Right?
Because
you can't get those tickets.
Because they're not giving them up.
Hell no.
And I am so happy about
that. I love that.
I think the only celebrity we saw was 50 Cent. And he actually knows somebody in the Kings organization. Yes. And so he was probably already going to be there. He probably
got it. Yeah.
But I love that he's here all the time. I think that's amazing that 50 Cent is here. It's so true.
I do too.
But anyway, I'm with you. I love seeing all the little kids super low.
Oh my God.
There were so many like 10 and 11 year old boys.
Families.
Like
just
4 rows from the floor. And I'm like, this is how it should always be.
And that's one of the reasons why I think Sacramento has such a strong following, specifically for the Kings, because they're really the only thing we have to like cling to.
Well, it's the only local pro team.
Right. And so, So agreed. Agreed. I so, so much great. Fun. It was so fun to watch.
I love
it. I couldn't believe how insane I got because I...
Sacramento pride, man.
I mean, and I kept waiting for something bad, like the scores to get like so far apart. Yeah. We're like, there's no way we're going to win. No, it never happened. It
never did.
The whole game was super exciting.
Well, it's like I turned it on and I said, oh man, we've got like 10 minutes and we're 10 minutes into the fourth and it's close. And the Kings were up by 2. And Daryl goes, really? Because last time I looked, we were way losing. And I said,
I never really saw them way losing. I mean,
they were double digits for like a minute.
A minute. Like but nine, it was like 9 points was early the longest in the game. Spread. Yeah.
Yes.
They really just never, So, you know, and the longer it went on, the more I'm like, this is actually like freaking amazing.
There's some really good players. And I just, they even said, they go, we stepped out on the court and it was like electricity.
It was so fun. It was insane. Yeah. So, I mean, this was one of those nights where everywhere in town, no matter where you were, the bars, the restaurants were packed.
Yes.
I went to the grocery store, unbeknownst to me, because yesterday was Saturday. It was my first day off of a brutal week of work. I was like walking around with slits in my eyes and sunglasses. I was so tired. Well, what I didn't realize because I didn't literally crawl out of my house till like 2 o'clock, the stores were in shambles. Everybody had been there already.
There was no food.
I couldn't find a chicken wing to save my life.
We went to the grocery store. I said, why is there no
nothing?
Food?
And all literally. All of the junk food.
All of
chicken wings, all the steaks were gone. Anything there you could barbecue, grill, or quick, you know.
That is so funny. I didn't even think about that.
Yeah, I couldn't find it. I was going to like, you know what? It might be nice to have a steak tonight on the grill and like maybe some shrimp cocktail. Not a shrimp to be found.
Empty shelves.
Everything was
and
gone.
And I said, why is it empty? And there was nobody trying to stock it.
No.
The line, they were exhausted.
By the time I got to the meat guys were like, what the fuck do you want? I was like, nothing. Sorry. No.
It was crazy, but it was so fun. And
it was fun.
I'm just like, I followed the Kings back when they were good.
Yeah.
And then it was funny. I was telling Daryl, I said, I remember my first Kings game.
Oh, me too.
And I was 16. I was dating a boy in high school and the Kings had just gotten here. Mm-hmm. Like they were still wearing baby blue.
Right.
And his parents got tickets through someone's work or whatever. Cause they were literally just giving them away
at the time. Yeah.
Cause they weren't good and you know, whatever,
but
it was
new.
A pro team and everybody was like, oh, we have a pro team. Oh my God. So he's like, hey, do you want to come with me and my family to see the Kings? And I went, absolutely. That'd be great.
Something different. Never done it.
So we go and I'm really excited. I'm like, wow, I've never been to a basketball. I mean, I have been to basketball games, but in the Bay Area. You know, I've never been.
I had
here.
Not.
It was so exciting.
Kings was my first NBA game.
So when I tell you that the seats were the last row at the top, they were the last row
legit.
At the top. And there was no one in front of us. It was like rows and rows and rows of vacancies.
You could actually have gone down, but we're such non-rule breakers. We probably didn't.
Oh no, you and I would have gone down.
Eventually, but I mean, I remember going to concerts where I was like in my seat and there were seats everywhere and I'm like, well, I don't know if we should.
Oh, you're different than me.
We're gonna get in trouble.
I don't. Yeah. I'm like, send me back. I don't give a crap. Yeah. I do not care. I will go down. So we're sitting there and there's like hundreds of rows in front of us. We could have even gone down to this first level and probably sat and it would have been fine, which I've done before at a Kings game. So I'm sitting there, my 16-year-old self already going, really? This is where we're sitting.
This is like lame.
I remember turning to him and going, there's nobody else. I think we can probably move down. And maybe he's like, no, these are our seats. We can't move. Oh, and I'm like, God. Oh, fuck.
You're one of those.
Yeah. And I'm like, damn, I'm 16 and I already know that this is bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm like, all right, here we go. Go Kings. Oh, I think there's a little dot down there. I see a little blue.
Is that the ball?
And I was like, in my mind, I'm like, I will never sit in the heavens again.
It's fun. And in fact, I went to a Kings game with Paula years ago. It was a business game that I got invited to and I took her as my plus one.
That's awesome.
Yeah, she ended up, you know, deep throating tongues with the guy that I went with, but whatever.
I remember that.
Yeah, he was cute. I was like, go ahead. I'm married, unfortunately. Go for it. Yeah. So, but anyway, yeah, but it was it's a great time. So, I mean,
I have sat low, much lower.
Oh my God.
Never courtside, but like three rows from the front. And it's so cool.
Yeah. I was just about to say, I think Jerry and I had tickets to the playoffs when they went 17 years ago and we had money and it was the year that, my daughter was like in high school or old enough to where I didn't have to like be there, you know what I mean? And we had money. I mean, that was the big thing is we had money and we literally sat like three rows up from the floor.
It's so
not
different.
Knowing how freaking fantastic that was.
It spoils you rotten.
I'm like, how could you, who sits up there?
No one.
Who?
I mean, well, you know what?
Families, if I you have this, a bunch of people and you want to go.
It's totally fun.
Oh my God.
And they
do
take care of those people up there.
They do.
People get rewarded for sitting, for definitely. Showing up and sitting up there because they know they're shitty seats.
And you know what? And looking back, we've talked about how fucked up our childhood was, but one of the things that we never did was like fun stuff. You know what I mean? Like our parents never took us anywhere. We didn't go to sports games or
not really.
You know, people talk about, oh, my dad just took me to baseball games. Mm-hmm. That was our thing. You know, we have none of that.
Not really.
So I'm sorry. Even if you don't have a lot of money and you have a lot of children or whatever, it is something you can do.
Yeah.
That you could actually afford.
The River Cats is perfect for that.
I've heard.
We've taken the kids many times.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, it's cheap, and you can even do the lawn for like $2.
Right? And it's still so fun. Cheap.
And it's so fun to see.
Yeah.
Because those guys they're so good.
They are good. They're the ones that end up playing for the Dodgers and stuff.
No,
and the
Giants.
A's. I mean, that's what I meant.
Yes.
Sorry, how dare you? You know what?
How dare you?
We have had so much shit smack talk this week at work because baseball is back on.
Oh, the Giants suck ass.
Well, whatever. I still watch faithfully. In fact, I had the game on before I left.
Oh, no, we watch. We will always watch.
But there's always that LA, San Francisco divide.
Oh, yes.
You know, so yes, all week long I've been hearing it. And so it's in my brain, but yeah.
So funny.
It's true.
Anyway. All right. Well, that's the show for this week. Thank you for listening to our rants and our... Yeah. Whatever.
Our sports talk, you girls, like, tuned out about 8 minutes ago.
Sports! Yes. Anyway, all right, well, we'll see you next week. Bye! Bye.